Dear friends, English Literature, Introduction to Poetry, Crossing Brooklyn Ferry by Walt Whitman. Short questions with answers. Question 1. How does the poet address the water of the river, clouds of the west, the sun and hundreds of people that cross the Brooklyn Ferry? Answer. While crossing the Brooklyn Ferry, the poet addresses the various objects of nature and the people crossing the ferry. First of all, he addresses the flood tide of the Brooklyn River below. He looks down from the ferry boat and says that he sees it face to face. Then he addresses the clouds of the west and the sun there half an hour high and tells them that he meets them face to face. Then he addresses crowds of men and women attired in the normal costumes and tells them that they are very curious to him. Rather, they are more curious to him than they may imagine. After that, the most strange and uncommon thing that he does is to address the hundreds and thousands of people that shall cross the river in future, hundreds of years from his time, and tell them they are very curious to him. The poet addresses various objects of nature which are considered beautiful to him, and all the ferry passengers of the present, past, and future as curious, are singular or wonderful. Question 2. Explain the following with reference to the context. The simple, compact, while joint scheme, myself, disintegrated, everyone disintegrated, yet part of the scheme. Explanation. This is a single line of verse, though it covers more than one line on the page of the book, which occurs in Walt Whitman's poem Crossing Brooklyn River. The poet has described the nature of the compact while joint scheme. The poet considers himself and all others as part of the compact while joint scheme, which he considers the universe to be. Though he himself and all others seem disintegrated or discrete, they are a part of the same thing. The things of the past are similar to those of the future. The experiences derived through the smallest sights and sounds are strung together like beads. The poet gathers experiences during his walk in the street or his passage over the river. He gathers experiences from his ties with others, their love, their sights and hearings in future also. Others will enter the gates of the ferry and cross from shore to shore. They will have the same experience as poet and other passengers are having now. The poet is of the opinion that all these things and beings of the past, present, future are connected to each other because they are parts of the same compact scheme. They receive the impalpable sustenance from each other as they are members of the same organization or organism. Cushion or one existence. Okay. Question 3. Explain with reference to the context. Had gall, anger, lust, hot wishes, idea not to speak, was wayward, vain, greedy, shallow, sly, cowardly, malignant. Explanation. These lines have been taken from the poem Crossing Brooklyn Ferry by Walt Whitman. The poet expresses his identity with all other people in respect of the mental qualities, feelings, and emotions, which normally derogatory or blameworthy, but which all people have to some degree or some degree more or less. He had dark patches, moments of negative thoughts like other people. When he conceived great thoughts, he was not sure whether they were meager or of little value. Like other people, the poet also knew that it is to be evil. He too told lazy tales, blushed from shame, resented someone's actions and words. He also lied, stole, and grazed other people's welfare. He too had cunning and deceit, anger, lust, and two indecent sexual wishes. He was also wayward, vain, greedy, shallow, sly, cowardly, and malignant. He too had the snake, the wolf, and the hog in him. He too had the cheating look, said the frivolous things, and had the adulterous wish. He refused other people's wishes or proposals, had feelings of hate towards others, had meanness and laziness, and all such derogatory mental states and feelings. The poet has very frankly admitted his moral weaknesses, which make him equal with all other humans of all times, past, present, and future. Question 4. What activities of inmate relationship made the people identified with others? Or what activities of the poet contributed towards the development of his identity with others? Answer. The poet has mentioned many of the activities that contributed towards the development of his identity with his fellow beings. He spent days with them. He had the haps or accidental chance of meeting with them. While he was a young man, he had many young friends. They called his names. His different friends knew him by different names, almost correctly, with their clear, loud voices as they saw him approaching or passing, or when he remained standing somewhere, he felt their arms on his neck, or when he remained seated somewhere, they reclined against his body, and he felt their negligent leaning of their flesh against him. He loved many of the young acquaintances whom he met in the streets or ferry boat or public assembly, but yet he never told them a word about his love. He lived the same life with them, and he had the same life with the rest of them. He had the same old laughing, gnawing, and sleeping. He played the role in life, the role that people make as great as they like, or as small as they like, or both great and small. Question 5. Explain the following with reference to the context. We understand then, do we not, what I promised without mentioning it? Have you not accepted what the study could not teach, what the preaching could not accomplish, is accomplished, is now, is it not? Explanation. These lines occur in the poem Crossing Brooklyn Ferry by Walt Whitman, great American poet of the 19th century. In these lines, the poet has expressed his basic philosophy of the interrelationship of all things and beings and an individual's impalpable sustenance from all things which are parts of all joint scheme. This relationship between things can be physical as well as spiritual. For example, he pays tribute to the beauty of Manhattan and asks what can be more stately and admirable than Manhattan bordered with masts. He also asks what can be more beautiful than the river and the sunset and the scalloped waves of the flood tide. The answer is clearly understood. Nothing can be more stately or beautiful. The man can clasp him by the hand and call him promptly and loudly as his correct name are more than gods. Nothing can be more subtle than the relationship which lies him to the omen or man that looks in his face. The poet then asks, whatever we understand, whether we understand the relationship of all things and beings or not, then expects that all people understand what the promised without mentioning it. That is, he promised to make his real interrelationship clear to us. He also expects us to accept his doctrine. Study of different sciences could not have taught his lesson. Religious teachers could not have taught it either. Question 6. How does the poet receive impalpable sustenance from all things? Answer. The poet says he receives impalpable sustenance from all things at all hours of the day. Though he is a discreet element in the simple, compact, oil-joint scheme, yet he is part of it. Everyone is like him, though they seem to be separated, but actually they are part of it. part of the compact scheme. In respect of time also, all things of the past, present, future are joined together, though they seem to be separated by the divisions of time. The experiences that the poet derives through his smallest sights and hearings are strung together like beads. The next generations and generations after him will be tied all together. The ties between the poet and those of all generations, their love, sights and hearings, and all other experiences all contribute to the poet's experiences. People are crossing the ferry now. In future, also they will cross the ferry. They will also watch the sun. They will also watch the run of the flood tide. You see the shipping of Manhattan north and west, the heights of Brooklyn to the south and east, and the island large and small. 50 years from now, they will also enjoy the same sights and sounds. The poet receives his sustenance from the wild giant thing because all things, including himself, things of the past, present, future, are related to each other. Question 7. What will the other people from the hundreds of years from the poet's time do? Or how does the poet address himself who will come many generations after him? According to the poet, distance in time and place does not matter at all. He addresses people of the many generations of future time in such a way that he seems to speak from the past to the people of the present time. He tells them just as they feel when they look on the river and the sky. He feels in the past as a member of a living crowd. He felt refreshed by the gladness of the river as they are feeling now. Just as a look on the innumerable masts of ships and the thick stamped pipes of steamboats, he looked. While crossing the ferry, he saw the seagulls high in the air, floating with motionless wings, oscillating their bodies as they are seeing now. He looked on the hedge on the hills that spread southward and westward, southwestward, as they are now looking on. He looked toward the lower bay and saw the ships arriving as they are looking. He saw the ships at the anchor and the sailor at work in the rigging or going up the masts around them as they are seeing. He saw the large and the small steamers in motions, the pilots in the pilot house, the flags of all nations flying atop innumerable ships, and they are coming down at sunset as they are seeing at the moment. He saw on the neighboring shores the fires from the foundry chimneys burning high and glaring into the night as they are seeing now. Okay, thank you friends for watching my video.